That's my introduction. This is a series that I do around the country called Lost Among the Least, because these are the least people on earth as the world measures them. And as a result of that, I felt, as I lived in the slums with the brethren in India, in Andhra Pradesh, in East Godavari district, I found myself as an American extremely lost among them. And they will preach the gospel powerfully, as you're about to see here as we get through this. There's going to be a little bit, this is a very different seminar than I normally do, because I go into a lot of backstory of the Indian culture, the caste system. I'm going to go into a little bit of how we got involved with them, because everyone always asks, so I'm going to pop that in here. But what I really wanted to focus on is what they've gone through in the last 18 months. Because it makes what we went through pale in comparison. That was a fun year, wasn't it? You know, 2020 is the year that most of us would rather just forget about. You know, it's almost surreal to recall that life as we knew it would be changing forever after January of that year. By April, we had new terms and we had a new language. Flatten the curve, social distancing, mask mandates, essential businesses. Suddenly Americans decided that they were not prepared and flooded the big box stores to hoard toilet paper and hand wash. This is my local Walmart and my local Kroger. They suddenly decided that we lived in North Korea after a plague of locusts had just left. That's what it looked like. Empty. Welcome to North Korea. And as the months wore on, much of the country found itself locked up at home. In addition, we heard a new term, the new normal. Schools were closed, church services were canceled indefinitely, holy days were online via Zoom or GoToMeeting, the feast was canceled. The businesses who defied mandatory closure orders were bolted and chained shut. The governor of this state sent the state police to arrest church members of a Baptist congregation for daring to meet in a parking lot to hear a service on their car radios. The new normal meant Orwell was a prophet. So as 2020 came to an end, we collectively told 2020, good riddance to bad rubbish. We simply could not imagine things being any worse than what they were. But then along came 2021, and basically this happened. Here, hold my beer. Watch this. And as difficult and frustrating as we assert life was for us in this country, we tend to limit our focus to our little bubble of self and forget that this pandemic was global in scope. All around the world, we had people getting sick and dying and tyrants advantaging circumstances to establish power for themselves over their people. Life here may not have been fun, but in places like India, where life as a Christian was already difficult before the Chinese bioweapon got loose, the pandemic visited difficulties and pain upon our brethren far worse than we've suffered here. So I wanted to share with you today what life was like for our persecuted brethren during their pandemic lockdowns, to help us look inside of our own limited worldview and present the amazing testimony of their total focus to serve the saints, the widows, the orphans, and to do Matthew 28, 19 and 20. To preach the gospel despite the danger and the risk to themselves, which is even greater than it normally is. My involvement in India, just to get this in here, so people are going to ask, began probably 2007, 2008. I'm not going to make a long story short. My daughters got called first. They said Brian and Stephanie Smith came back with a presentation, and I was self-employed at my own business, and my youngest daughter said, yeah, we're going to go on this mission trip with Brian and Stephanie. And my mind, I could hear that still small voice in the back of my head, you should go. And I shut that down. I'm not going to India. I don't like Indians. I'm from Chicago. We have a big Indian population, and they're rude, and they'll cheat you. And they ran all the Dunkin' Donuts and 7-Elevens up there. Stereotypes, sorry about that. Didn't like them at all. And so I'm not going to India. I don't like anything about it. And my two daughters stood up, and they were 14 and 16 at the time, correct? And they said, well, we're going, which began a war in my household. Even my wife and I are, no, you guys are too young to go on the other side of the planet. after 9/11, because that was my fear. I didn't want to get on an airplane. You know, that was, I was scared to death. And but eventually, my youngest daughter, Rianne, who some of you have met, she'll be here at some point today, looked at me and says, "Daddy, you said that we are a gift from God and that we don't belong to you." And I said, "That's right." She goes, "Why are you standing in God's way?" So then my wife then jumps, "Yeah, Michael, why are you standing?" So, you know, it's four versus one at that particular point in time, and you're going to lose. So that was the hardest thing I had to do up to then, was let them go in 2008. They went to Brian and Stephanie. It was all young people, because all the parents that tried, that either chickened out or tried to go, God put a block. So the Joshua generation in the Church of God did the first mission trip among lay people that probably ever happened within the Sabbatarian community, as far as I'm aware of. So they went, and when they came back, I saw the videos of what they had done, and I was so proud as a father what they accomplished. But at the same time, I was so ashamed, because they had done more in their, in, you know, at 14 and 16 than I had done in 20 plus years of warming a seat in at the Church of God. They had done more to preach the gospel, to serve the widow and the orphans, and I was ashamed, but proud as a dad. So in 2009, Brian Smith emailed me and said, "Hey, there's an opportunity to go to India, and I think God wants you to go." And I, after all that shame and feeling this big, because my kids, of course my answer was going to be, "No, I'm not going to India." Thus began a wrestling match with the Almighty. And I wasn't wrestling with the Almighty in order to be able to get a blessing. I was wrestling because I didn't want to do what he was calling me to do. I don't recommend this, because every excuse I threw up there about why I can't go, God took away, including my career. Because I prayed and said, "I know you want me to go, but they're already laying people off from the slowdown of 2008. And if I tell my clients I'm going to be gone for a month to go to India, I'm going to lose my last client. Can't afford it. My wife's in nursing school. I'm going to lose my job. So I know you, but I can't." 8 a.m. the next, very next morning after that prayer, the phone rings. It's the art director from, and he says, "Michael, we're letting you go." God's like, "What else you got? Come on. Come on." So I ended up surrendering, and, well, actually, no, I didn't. It was I continued to fight, and that was in December. So New Year's Eve, 2008, I finally got, broke me down, because what happened is I got sitting at my computer just reading the news, I get an email from Chidi Gampala Babu, and he was the pastor that took care of my kids. I saw his pictures and his videos. Get an email from him. "Brother Michael, I'm so pleased to meet you." He goes, "God wants you to come to India, because I'm so blockheaded, I need neon signs and a sledgehammer. Hello, hello, stupid, hello." And at that point, I was looking at all the pictures and everything that my kids had done. So I got mad at God. I said, okay, I'll go. And I got mad, because I lost my career. I had no income. My wife's in nursing school. And I'm like, "All right, I'll do this. But you're going to have to, I'll do what you want me to do. I'll knock on doors, you know, put signs up on the street. But you're going to have to provide everything necessary in order to get me there." Because I had to come up with like $2,500 for the airfare. And no, it wasn't the next day. For airfare, I had to come up with, and the hotel, because we had to pay our own way. And I called Brian Smith at 9 o'clock on New Year's Eve. And I said, "All right, Brian, I'm going to go on this trip. I think God wants me to go." And he says, "I know God wants you to go." And so I was, "All right, I'm committing." He says, "Good." He goes, "Now," he goes, "first hurdle is holiday week." And he goes, "I got to have $250 here to hold your seat by," I forget what day it was, Tuesday. We had like 2 or 3 days, because it was holiday weekend because of New Year's. So I'm like, "What am I going to get $250? We don't have enough money to pay the light bill." I'm just telling you a quick miracle. And so what ended up happening was I called all the people that owed me money. I tried people if I could borrow $250, no dice. So the day came when I had to have it to Brian, and I'm like, "Okay, I don't have it. I'm not going to make it." So I committed, but it didn't work out. I just went to go pick up the phone to dial Brian, and the phone rings. It's Brian. Pick up the phone. He goes, "Hey, Brian." I says, "Hey, Brian, I was just going to call you." He says, "I was going to call you first. I got great news." He goes, "I happened to get the mail this morning. There was an envelope to our Cardias ministry, and inside was a note saying, this is for someone that needs $250 to go to India." Just like that. There's my first, again, my whole first, there's so many miracles in doing in this trip. It's just mind-blowing. But that was the first one. I don't have time to go on the flight. You can ask me afterwards what my flight there to India was like. And so that began my, in 2010, in April of that year, Brian and I went to India. That was my first time there. And ever since then, half my heart is there. And that's my brother Chidi on the left in the blue shirt. That's one of the widows. And those are the widows in front there in the congregation there in India. Let me describe what India is like, though, because as an American, you will short circuit. Being a Christian in India is to embrace a life knowing you are seen as subhuman. You exist outside the caste system, and it is permissible for anyone to abuse, cheat, steal, maim, and kill you. Christians make up less than 2% of the population, which is 83% Hindu and 13% Muslim. Most Christians live in the slums, villages that are on the outskirts of major urban centers in the mostly rural rice delta. They're exceedingly poor. Poverty on a scale, and I mean this, you cannot wrap your mind around. They have no ability via education, merit, or hard work to improve their lot in life. Once you're born into a low caste, you remain there for life because you're paying the penalty of the sins of all your past lives. As the other castes are going to ensure that you stay in your spot. It's a pecking order, a top-down hierarchical system. There are thousands of castes within castes. Choosing to become a Christian will automatically expel you from your caste if you're higher up and relegate you to the ranks of the Adiandra or the Untouchables. And your own family will become your chief persecutor and exiler, which fulfills what Jesus said. Your own enemies will become those of your household. Life is hard and cheap. As low caste in India, they can only do menial labor jobs such as working in rice fields, handling the dead, cleaning out sewers, or making poo patties. That's what they cook with, by the way. That's human and animal dung mixed with straw. And they put it in the sun, and they let it dry, and they light it. It's like their sterno. That's what they cook with, because there's not a lot of the trees that burn. They're all coconut trees and things like that there. And that's all they are allowed to do. Life's, you know. So widows and orphans are forced to beg in the streets, and they're considered cursed people. Electricity is sporadic. Most homes and shacks are devoid of but two sets of clothes, one pot and a spoon to cook from. Shopping for food is an everyday necessity or every other day necessity because there's no electricity, there's no refrigeration. Markets, you go and they sell vegetables and wares out of stalls or on tarps spread on the ground. That's Chidi, the pastor of the House of God. He's holding the watermelon. That's my brother. And despite these daily hardships, the focus of our brethren in India is to preach the gospel and serve one another in aid and provision. Their commitment to do Matthew 28, 19, and 20 puts any effort I have ever made to absolute shame. As a body, they are working to teach their children to become missionaries, and they preach boldly, often inviting the hatred and abuse of other Hindus and Muslims. And I've experienced it and seen it firsthand. There's nothing so much fun as having bricks thrown at your head when you're walking down to do a baptism. So, when the lockdown of Andhra Pradesh began due to the global pandemic, when it took place, what I experienced is an unlivable situation of everyday life for our brethren in comparison to the life we're used to in this country was suddenly made much, much worse for them. The lockdown there was enforced by the police and the military. Everything was ordered closed. Every single person was ordered to remain inside their homes with the shutters and windows closed. It never got below 95 degrees when I was in India, day or night. The temperature climbed 115 degrees. They live in some poured concrete pillboxes with brick, so their homes act as a kiln. They absorb all the heat during the day, and at night it radiates in. These people were baking inside their homes, no doors or windows allowed to be open by military order. This was G. Mami Dada. You remember that, Erica, don't you? It's the town just walking distance, about 3/4 mile from Chidi's home in the slum village of Lanka. This is where the market, where the food is purchased every day for the next day's cooking. This is where you got to go, this village there. This was G. Mami Dada after the lockdown. Everything was shuttered. All the stores were and stalls were shuttered. Even the dogs were starving more than they usually are out there. And I don't think my wife has seen these pictures. And you've been there. We've been in that shop together. And things got even worse. Here's some evidence of what they had: bullhorns shouting at people, threatening people if they were out to go back into your homes, or you're going to be beaten and arrested. That's just how things were there. This is from the newspaper, the Hindustan Times. The police in Andhra Pradesh on Thursday sentenced a group of 13 people to imprisonment and penalized each of them 1,000 rupees for violating the lockdown. Persons convicted, all right, so they're in prison for violating, but they're not convicted yet, okay? Persons convicted face up to a year in prison for violating government orders. Loudspeakers ordered homes and businesses to close their shutters and doors, and these 13 refused to close their windows, citing the oppressive heat with temperatures soaring. Those caught outside their homes or with open windows without police permission were beaten and arrested, which of course is done to great applause by the upper castes. One person from one household was permitted once a week to be escorted to a single open market stall by the police, where they would be able to buy a limited amount of fruits and vegetables after paying police bribes. Many brethren are wholly dependent upon the church congregation to sustain them. And in the example of serving one another, the brethren took their once-in-a-week shopping excursion not to purchase for themselves, but to look to everyone in the congregation to provide for. And despite the lockdowns being imposed, the great fear of the Gopala ministry was not hunger, because they were hungry. It was the inability for them to get together to worship, to pray for one another, to encourage one another, to be steadfast in the faith. That is their main driving goal. Their main worry was protecting their congregations from lethargy and heresy, if not outright apostasy. And that worry is well-founded, because during the lockdown of 2020, the Gampalas lost two congregations near Kakinada, as one Hindu came in and got a local congregation of three families to renounce Christ and convert back to Hinduism, and that happened under threat. They were threatened to be killed if they didn't do it. And the other congregation outside the city had a Sunday pastor come in and just steal the entire congregation. So that's why they work so hard to develop anchors to their congregation, so they're not easily taken away. To be shepherds of their flocks is a serious and constant focus of the Gampala ministry. They recognize that they are aberrations in Satan's playground. They are intruders in a holy pagan system where demons control the land and the population. Being here in America, often learning the hardships via email, it can be frustrating because I'm here, I'm helpless to do anything but to pray for them. You know, for example, I got one night, my wife will tell you, don't cry, honey. I got a frantic call from Chitty. He said, Brother Michael, call all the brethren in the USA. Pray for us. They're coming. And I hear all the shouting in the background. What's happening? They're coming. Just pray for us. Pray for our protection. Pray we survive. Please. And the line goes dead. I'm all the way in the United States. He's all the way on the other side of the planet. And both of us were hysterical because we had no idea what was going to happen to them. You know, you feel so helpless. And that's everyday life. You never know if you wake up in India if that you're going to walk out your door and a brick's going to hit you side of the head and kill you. And it's okay. It's perfectly legal because you're Christian and you're Adiandra. So anyway, they suffered two bouts with this pandemic and two lockdowns. They had a lockdown in early 2020 during the spring holy days that lasted about 3 weeks. And then the explosive Delta variant hit them earlier this year that locked them down in their home for over 3 months. So I thought it best to share with you some of the correspondence before we get into the videos that they made. Hopefully, these are the letters I got from Chitty and Prasad and Sagar. Hopefully, you'll get a sense of the hardships and worries they faced and realize their focus and their hopes is inspiring. So this letter here is from my son Prasad. He writes, and I put the words up here, you can follow along. March 27th, he wrote me, he says, "Dear brethren, we had a blessed Thanksgiving prayer meeting at Rajupalayam last Wednesday night. Besides that, as we are going to be affected by the dreadful virus, and we don't know the moment of lockdown in our state, so we as serpent as wise, to be wise, need to utilize the time in a proper way. Last year, we were not able to celebrate the Feast of Passover and Unleavened Bread due to the pandemic. But now, in His richest grace, we are ready to celebrate the feast days. So please lift us up in your prayers for peaceful and safe conditions. On April 10th, here we go, he wrote, "Today we had faced danger at the time of Sabbath worship at Rajaropeta, which is the place of worship, which is their house. Our opposite neighbor, with the help of Hindu radical, has created a lot of disturbance and threatened us and our members. He threatened to kill them. Today, Sabbath worship, because of Hindu radical threats, our sisters are afraid to join worship with us. Brother Skip Martin, please inform all our dear brethren in Bible Home Fellowship to please pray for us." And you get these letters and you feel helpless to do anything for them. On April 27th, should have timed these quicker, he says, "As I have written in the last few months, the Abba Father has been gracious in keeping us safe and enabling us to..." Huh? Oh. Oh, did it go too fast? I may have. Might be next. Hold on a moment. Okay, so 428. Well, I'll just read then 27. He says, "Abba Father has been gracious in keeping us safe and enabling us to carry on the work of Elohim in India, where the people have been greatly impacted by the coronavirus. Widespread sickness, unemployment, and transportation difficulties are causing many people to suffer in their daily lives, making things more difficult. Please pray for God's mercy on the people of India during this difficult time." And then on 428, he says, "I hope you are all doing well. As you are hearing that the new strain of COVID virus is affecting many people in my area, and we are not allowed to conduct any meetings or church gatherings too. There will be complete lockdown, has ordered maybe 1st of May, again, his English, please do pray for us so that our Abba Yahweh would keep, protect, and strengthen us to survive bravely at this time of pandemic situation. We are continually are praying for you all." And by the way, they do. When I say continually praying for us, ask me afterwards what I've witnessed, how they pray for us. It's amazing. "Trusting that our Abba Yahweh will protect you all from this dreadful disease for his name's sake. Amen." And then I got an email from Sagar Jolly, who runs the orphanage there. He wrote and said, "There are 103 pastors have died in our state because of COVID-19. Every day, thousands of people are dying now. We pay our heartfelt thanks for great love and prayers for us. We are all praying for you, dear brothers and sisters, your brother in Christ, Sagar, and all the orphans at Hebron." Got a letter then on May 9th. That was our anniversary, by the way. I got that letter from Sagar. On 5/16, got an email from Chidi. "How are you, brother? Sorry to inform you that there are some widows and congregation members that are sick with COVID. They are very poor and unable to survive at this time of pandemic due to a breakdown of their regular work and unable to buy food. So I am prayerfully thinking to buy a large quantity of citrus, fruits, eggs, portions, and vegetables for a week so that they can get recovery from COVID. Our government is unable to make any provisions. There is no supply of oxygen for those who are on ventilators, so we would like to buy an oxygen cylinder and a pulse oximeter to use for those in our congregations who are in critical condition." And so, do you remember he talked earlier about being wise as serpents? You know, we in America are kind of, we're law-abiding people. So if the government says, oh, there's a lockdown and you can't go here, you can't go there, we obeyed. Well, the brethren in India understand the application that, well, they're being starved to death now. So wise as serpents, they went out and bribed one of the police guards out there with money, and he allowed them to go when it wasn't their day to go to the store and snuck them around the back way to the market, and they bought food for the entire congregation. This is their prayer over all the food that they were able to get for the brethren, 300-plus members of their congregation. That's Chitty praying with his hands out. You'll see me do that because that's how I pray. and that's a pile of rice, and they basically provide them foodstuffs and things and to keep them alive. He said, Brother Michael, we must be wise as a cobra to slither. He said, yes, they make many laws, but we will all die by obeying these laws, so they have to slither through them because God's law comes first for them. So even though, here's a letter, I think, coming up. So this is the distribution that they did for, they put them all in bags, and we gave them money, and he got a portable oxygen and a pulse oximeter for the brethren because they're too poor to go to the hospital. There's no medical care for them, so any medical care is going to come from the pastors in India. So let's continue on here. This is my son Prasad, who adopted me because I have three daughters and no sons. And he wrote to me on May 19th and said, even though the Elohim impressed on my mind a desire to reach beyond the people and my believers through social media, he names the applicant WhatsApp, Zoom, Google Meet, and Telegram, during this quiet time, because they were locked down, every day I am excited about sharing the good news and corona precaution to my villagers, these are Hindus, with love and affection without any fear. We had provided common necessity, rice and vegetables, for our congregation members in this time of crisis. We only supplied these things at their doorstep with safety precautions to avoid gathering, so he wouldn't get arrested. He says, I am too busy schedule of preparing video, audio messages, and literature to work to encourage our dear ones and make them stand firm in the faith. Dear brethren, we pray earnestly for all of my dear instruments of gospel, my family, and Yeshua. And that's my son, Prasad. He writes again on May 25th. This is actually Chitty, his uncle, Prasad's uncle, my brother. As of now, we are doing okay, but I'm sad to say 70% of our congregation members are being sick with COVID. Please do lift us up in your daily prayers for my family's congregation members' protection and for those who get sick to get recovery soon. We thank you for your love and kind concern. That was May 25th. Then on June 10th, this is Chitty again, my brother. As of now, my family is in a restricted zone, the red zone. Sorry to inform you that Sister Savayathi, 56 years old, has died from COVID. Many are still recovering. Please do lift us up in your daily prayers for my family's protection and for those who are sick to get complete recovery soon. So, Sister Savayathi died. This is Sister Savayathi. This is the last time I was in India. And she was crying. She didn't want to let me go. And she said, I am afraid I'll never see you again. And I said to her, yes, you will. If not in this flesh, you will see me in glory, and you in glory will be together in the kingdom of God. And she stopped crying after that. I got a letter in July 14th. They started coming out of the pandemic. It says, by the grace and protection of our Abiyah, through all of your intercessory prayers, we are all doing okay, and the coronavirus is being decreased daily. But night lockdown is still continued here. So I was feeling a little better that they were starting to come out of it in July. And then I got this letter from Chitty a day later, or the 16th of July. He wrote to me, I would like to remind you of the situation here in Rajapalayam and Lanka. As we do not have freedom of worship, we are not permitted to worship on Shabbats, as well as during the feast days, because we are located across the street near a Hindu leader, Gaddafi, who lives literally across the street from Pastor John's house. I've seen this guy, I've met this guy. He's Satan's instrument, causes a lot of trouble for them. And now he's big buddies with the police, so the beatings happen quite often. So he's complaining to the police, and they make us stop our worship. Often the new people are afraid to come to Shabbat and for any prayers. So, next, I'll make sure I get on the next slide. He writes, so, we are prayerfully thinking to build a sanctuary in the middle of our rice field property with a local builder which does not require government approval. This can be used for regular Shabbats as well as feast days if our Abba Yahweh willing. So this field that they're in, Nancy and Peter Ryle, they're Messianics on the East Coast, came up with $17,000 to purchase this 1 square acre of land that they could plant rice crops and crops. And they were hoping to build an ashram for the widows. An ashram is a place where the widows can stay. How do I describe this? The village of Rajapalayam, where Pastor John and Amma Ruth live, is down south. And about a mile up the road is the slum village of Lanka. So in between them is all rice fields. So in the villages, the Hindu leaders are there. So there's this field about halfway between the villages, which is in the middle of nowhere. It's all rice fields. And they can conduct their worship out there without, you know, irony, because the moment the Hindus hear their praise and worship, they're offended because they're insulting their gods. They're 300 million pagan gods, and they get the police to beat everybody in the congregation. So this is the field behind. You can see me in there. We were anointing bricks with oil that God will bless them with a place to meet and worship. And that's the field. As a matter of fact, when I was here in 2014, because of the Hindu leader, it was too dangerous for us to have Passover at Pastor John's house, at the house of God. His church is built on top of his roof. It was too dangerous. So we ended up doing Passover in this field. They brought this diesel generator and laid tarps on the dirt. And when we flipped the lights on, every single, you know, you complain about the bugs out here. Some people, why do you guys got all these weird bugs? That Passover was the Passover of the plagues of Egypt. And you're going to see, this is the field. They cleared it so we could lay tarps down. This is Passover. The plagues of Egypt I present you with. I can't even open my eyes. They were going to my eyes, up my nose, and my mouth, and they love white meat. That was the most, it was the most insane. I've never in my life been assaulted by that many insects at once. It was never ending. It was just, that's it. All right, we're celebrating Passover, but we're getting to experience the insect plague that happened in Egypt. So being able to meet in peace, it's been a constant desire for the brethren since I've known them to do that. Often they're beset by antagonists, by Hindu leaders. Sometimes jealous Sunday pastors work to rile up the Hindus and the Muslims to attack them. So it would be a great blessing if they're able to get this building constructed for their three local congregations. And I just saw pictures on, someone showed me, Erica, on Facebook of Prasad's. They did get the building built in the field there. They got the brick up, and they have a metal cross beams, and they have palm fronds over the top of it. So they do have a meeting out there in the field, so hopefully it won't be so buggy. Now, despite what I've read to you from all the correspondence, Prasad and Anusha wanted to talk with you directly. And we didn't know what the internet situation was going to be like, because last year during the feast, we did it online. And by magic, they had electricity, which is sporadic. You never know when you're going to have electricity. Pardon? Magic or God? Oh, it was God, because we were online, and then the brethren from India came online. And so Skip and about, 20 of us, I think Bernard was on for a little bit. He got to meet Chitty and Prasad, and we were talking in real time. And I thought it would be great if we could do that at the feast, where they could see you could see them, you could talk to them, they could talk to you, but we didn't know what the internet connection was be like, so I said, let's do the next best thing. Why don't you record a message for them and talk to them about what is happening with the pandemic and your mission work. And what I've done is, because they're self-taught in English, it's hard to understand them, so I've added subtitles so you could read along with what they're talking. But this is Prasad, my son, who adopted me as his daddy. He literally changed his name to Prasad Deering. Because so my name wouldn't die out, because I have three daughters. And so they're going to talk to you, Prasad and Anusha Gampala. Oh, I guess I didn't realize. Yeah, that's Prasad and Anusha.
Shalom to you all, dear prayer partners who love and pray for us regularly. We are very happy to meet you through this video. Psalmist declared in Psalms 119:68, "You are good, and what you do is good." We have in these days, under the grace of Elohim, In spite of our sufferings, we are affirmed in the presence of joy. We rejoice every time when we get an email from you all informing about your situations. We handed every situation into powerful hands of Elohim.
Shalom to you all. Elohim has answered and continue to answer the prayers of his people. We need to love him and have faith in him who called us. In this faith, representing our call and commitment in his knowledge, during this pandemic times, we are widely using technology to reach his people around the state. We conducted online Zoom classes based on scripture study programs and daily devotional programs to edify and sustain all of our dear ones in truth.
Even though the issues were hard around us, we never sat and worried about future. Since our concentration and comparison is eternity, Yahweh, our provider, enabled us to support and take care of two children, semi-orphans, in our home of comfort, whose father has died due to COVID. Actually, he is supposed to take baptism in the holy name, coming Feast of Tabernacle. But sadly, he passed away. Their family had not received any support from their relatives. So, we are helping them to lead their life normally, but we are in great need of provide a better education so that they could be able to stand on their feet. Besides this, we are also taking care of beloved widows at Rajarapeta. Never made them to lack of daily needs such as rice, vegetable and medical assistance. In these times of crisis, we too faced many challenges to survive. Sometimes it is very tough to pay the school fee of both my kids when school unlocks. We trust that your prayers led us.
Not only that, dear brethren, beyond this, we had worked among uncivilized and uneducated living in remote areas of Bihar and Jharkhand, not part of my country. We involved in preaching gospel to the unreached millions, feeding orphans and sending them after their education. They will associate with worldly things, losing their spirituality, going back to their past life. So we brought them up spiritually, deeply rooted in Sabbath truth, teaching and preaching in vernacular languages. Those are the languages which I have knew. We started witnessing for Messiah and ready to give our life in oppressing situations as we are facing now for the Sabbath truth. We also conducted seminars, and also we had translated the literature that they might be able to understand the truth in their languages, and it could be able to give a golden path for them to reach the scriptures in a proper way. We believe that, as Elohim said, that seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Also, we are eagerly waiting for the opportunity to knock at our door once to visit again and lit the lamp of true gospel among them. We urge all of you to pray that our Abba Father may enable us to move for his kingdom on the earth.
And that's Prasad and Anusha. Six. Anusha speaks six. She has the gift of tongues. She can speak six different languages. There are 1,875 official languages in India. In Telugu, there are like 250 dialects. Telugu itself is referred to as the Latin of the East. It's as difficult as English. You know how we have words that have different meanings? Like, hey, it's cool. Well, if it's cool, it could mean temperature, or it's really awesome and neat. So there's multiple meanings of words in the United States. It's worse in their language because you can only use certain words around certain people, certain relatives, depending if it's a male and a female or two males. It's just mind-blowing. It's just absolutely mind-blowing. It's always good to hear the testimony firsthand from the brethren rather than it just all coming from me. So hopefully you can feel a connection with them as they have with us, and they do have a connection with us, and the joy they have in knowing that we consider them to be part of our church family. And that way the world's going to know that we are his disciples when we have that love for one another. Roger talked about that. And they feel it from us, and I feel it from them. Hopefully you're able to get a little sense of that in their video from them. But I have one more letter to share, just to give you an idea of ministry in India. Not like it is in the United States. I got a letter that I'm going to share with you. This is Pastor John. This is Prasad's father. He sadly passed away a couple of years ago. And Chitty and Prasad and Ananda have had to take up the mantle of leading the congregations. He wrote me this letter on August 10th of this year. He's not writing it just to me, he's writing it to all of you. He said, "Dear brethren, our Elohim has put a burden for my dear ones, those who are washed in the blood of Yeshua and accepted his word." So he's talking about his congregations. "In the congregation of Rajupayam, Lanka, and Rajarpeta, as you are all serving all of them with much love. After the death of my beloved father, Pastor John, everyone has faced a lot of trouble for medical emergencies such as first aid and basic health care of beloved widows. It is much more dire for us now in these times of crisis of COVID. No one has fulfilled the role that my father's passing, since my father took since his passing. Now, his father, as pastor, is also the doctor of the congregation. Because Pastor John would have to take care of first aid needs, he would have to administer shots, he would have to take blood samples, blood pressure, and all of those things, just the way you go to those new medical things that, you know, what do they call those, Erica? Those medical places, they're not hospitals, but they're urgent care. Yeah, so he became like a doctor of an urgent care center for all the congregations and the brethren. They're too poor to go to a decent hospital in India. The government hospitals I've been to, one of the brethren there got a hernia. He didn't know it was a hernia. He thought it was cancer. He was going to die. I went to their government hospitals. It was the most horrifying thing I'd ever seen in my life, and I don't ever, you go in there, you don't come out alive. Kind of a thing. It's just a big giant building with beds lined up by the thousands in trenches behind the beds, and men and women, children, they don't segregate by, you know, you're just laid in a bed and the trenches are open with urine and feces and blood and just running down open. It's awful. So you have to get decent care, you have to pay bribes and go to a private hospital. So they needed somebody in the congregation to be able to take care of the widows. So he continues writing. There's my wife. He says, "So now I desire to train and equip myself in medical basic knowledge to serve God's people and to meet the need in time as Erica, mom, she's mom, served us when she was with us." Erica took Pastor John and upped his knowledge of how to take, right, Erica, blood pressure and help them become a better nurse practitioner for the congregation. Yes, all of those things. So he writes, "I am planning to join a certificate course for medical assistance. Dear brethren, please uplift me in my ambition to take my responsibility as well as like you for his work and my family in your valuable prayers. With love and peace, Evangelist Prasad Deering." And he's wants to be able to take care of everything he's already doing. You saw it, booklets, magazine, online programs. It's not enough. Now he's got to get a medical certificate so he could take care of everybody in the congregation that has first aid and emergency needs. I'm inspired, but I'm also exhausted for him. Look how exhausted I am at this feast, and I'm not even doing a fraction of what they have to do on a daily basis. It's just absolutely amazing. So again, ministry is 24/7 for our brethren in India. I continue to be stunned by the amount of work, continuous devotion to preaching the gospel and serving the congregations that they have. Despite even great hardship that would normally cause me to retreat into my own home and remain isolated, which did happen, I might add, our Indian brethren continually sought to slither through the lockdowns to be able to make provisions for the saints, and they worked tirelessly to protect the faith and their members, and they continually seek to serve them in myriad ways that continue to always amaze me. These are the least people on earth as the world measures them. Based on their fruits of service to one another and the gospel, I believe that they shall be called great in the kingdom of God. And we are blessed to see and hear their testimony and their witness of example. So let's give our Yahweh thanks for them and continually lift them up in prayer for the work that they're doing on the front lines of reaching the millions who have never heard of the name of Jesus Christ in India. Dhanyawadamalu. So I will take any questions anyone has at this time. And if you have them, please ask, and I'll be happy to share my understanding, having been there.
When they had all of the food and everything spread out for the week.
Yes.
Such a meager amount for so many, 300 and some people. What was the cost of something like that to sustain for a week?
Chitty actually told me that their prices have doubled in the last couple of months for food, and it's getting to the point where they can't afford it. I don't know what the amount of that provision was, but I know that in our ministry, John, we send them provisions. I'll try to break it down with feast funds. We send them, $350 or $400 to feed the congregation during the Holy Day? John, do you remember? Was it like $350?
Yes, it was. This has been a couple of years ago, but the amount was food and certain basic cares was about $35 per month per widow.
Right, per widow.
That's
full time.
Thereabouts, probably around $70 a month
right
now.
Mm-hmm. But to feed the entire congregation was like we would send them feast festival food. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's right. Yeah. Yeah, so like for the festival food for all members of the congregations, what we were sending them, what?
We were sending
350.
Per holy day, we were sending $350.
And that would feed every member of the congregation. And those were the best meals they would have all year because they could have actual meat. They'd have chicken and rice and Caroline, you have another question.
I guess I'm just trying to get an idea of what it costs there for them when they're working. What is a day's wages for them in comparison to the meager amount
for the Adiandra? Yeah, it's biblical. They get enough money per day for 12 hours of work in the rice fields, or digging out sewers, or handling the dead, or whatever, making poo patties. They get enough money per day to basically have one meal. They're the Adiandra. There's no chance to advance. I brought a computer and all my graphic software, and I taught my son how to do my job, to be graphic art and design, because there's banners and posters and billboards everywhere in India. And he's like, if you can learn this, then you could work and be self-sufficient. And the problem is not only with ministry, but they don't. Once they learn your caste, you're not allowed to go up. Okay, John, you had a question?
A question and comment to that. As far as the meals per feast, holy day, that's spring holy days, high days, and the fall high days, all of them, except for Day of Atonement, of course. But the situation there with Chitty and Prasad, is they not only had the widows and orphans, their congregation of their church, but quite frequently they would invite the village in as well and share the food with them as well as the messages. So they went as far as they could. They do serve the people.
Bless your enemies. They do that.
The comment I wanted to make is you might have noticed in the video with Prasad that he referred to depending on Elohim and God for all substance and blessings and everything. The thing that's hard to grasp initially is the fact that when they make those kind of comments, they are extremely sincere. It's coming from the heart. That's the way they believe every minute of every day. Mm-hmm. And so it's not just a saying that we might typically be used to in here, you know, thanking God for this, that, and the other in passing. It's they live it every minute of every day.
So Prasad and his family, what caste were they born into?
They're born into, well, they're Adiandra. So they're
Born into that caste.
They're born into the caste. The Gampala family was born in, actually, he told me what the name of the caste was, but it's outside. All right, give you a brief, quick caste lesson of India. There are five main castes. There's the Brahmins. Those are the priestly caste. Those are the ones that, they're like the mullahs of Iran. You know how they have a president, but we know that who really runs Iran are the mullahs. Same exact thing, only it's Hindu instead of Islam. So the Brahmins, when you're born in that caste, they're the top dogs. Underneath them are the Kshatriyas. Kshatriyas are the military, they're the enforcers, and they're the defenders of the country. So all of your police and military are in with the Kshatriya class. Below that is the Sudras. And they are the artisans and the craftsmen, people that actually make things and so forth. They're the merchant class. They're the ones that are permitted to own stores. They're the ones that are permitted to own businesses. They're the ones that run that. Below them are the, I don't know why I can't think of it at the moment, but there's a labor caste below them. And those are the ones that normally do fix your car, fix your bike, get electricity hooked up, those types of labor jobs, work the fields, do harvests and things, harvests with the nicer crops, herd goats, take care of things like that. That's the labor caste. Outside of that triangle, top down, this is the government, the way the government works, anything outside of that is non-human. They don't exist. If they're not within that caste, then they're not part of the head, arms, hands, and legs and feet of their gods. So they're not human. So the Gampalas are outside that caste system. But within those major castes, there are millions of castes within those castes. It's a pecking order, and it's just insanity. It's all Hinduism. Everything is through the prism of Hinduism. Everything in India is through all their education. You know, they need to send their kids, when he talked about enough money to pay school fees, they need to send them to a private school, which is, schools are compulsory, and there's no getting out of it, no homeschooling in India. So they have to go to a private school, they have to pay for it. Otherwise, if they go to a government school, everything, including their science, history, mathematics, everything is done through the prism of Hinduism, which in many cases makes absolutely no sense at all. Because it defies, logic, it defies science, but it doesn't matter. Their religion is, the Hindu religion governs everything in India.
All right, so Prasad and his family, they have they're in positions of service, and they're wearing, better clothes. It just seems like somebody from above them would come and want to squash them, that they can't.
Yeah. Oh yes.
All right. So how are they able to continue to do that and not and to survive, and that where how does the money get there?
Diane, I've been asking that myself, that very same question every time I see a video from them. I don't know how they do it. I came. Yep. Through George, we get it to them. John and I get it through. We do through electronic. We get donations from the brethren. We don't keep nothing. We send everything. Well, we always worried with the banks, but we were wise as servants. We have ways to get the funds directly to them. No middlemen. It just gets directly to them. How they survive and get through all these problems. I'm amazed. I don't know how. I folded like a cheap suit just watching what was happening to them.
They do encounter problems, and they get raided. That was what was happening, that phone call from Chitty that night. They all got arrested, beaten, put in jail. It was bad.
I noticed in some of the pictures, I just saw like rice and vegetables. Do they eat any meat? Or
The brethren do because they're Christian, but they have to buy their meat from Muslims because Hindus are vegetarians. I mean, strict vegetarians. They don't. There's such starvation there, and you see these giant cows with decorated with wreaths and gold and tinsel and ornaments, and there's all these starving people there, and there's all these giant fat cows, and I'm like, slaughter the cow, feed the kids. But their Hinduism, that's Satan's way, and it runs the whole country.
Don't they believe that, like, every single animal has a soul, and it's like a sin, basically, to kill any living thing?
Yeah, because Hindus believe in reincarnation. See, the interesting thing about the way the Gospels preached in India, and one of the things that got brought to my mind, which is, again, just personal story. First time when I go to live in India, we go to this village, all Hindus, little broken down village. Chitty sits me down. All these Hindus are sitting down, and he says, okay, now preach. My church background is such that I know how to preach against Christmas and Easter as pagan. I know how to excoriate people for worshiping on Sunday. But I had no idea how to preach the gospel to people that had no idea who the Creator was. I mean, I got so angry, and then it's like, what do I say? All I knew how to do was bash other Christians. I had no idea how to preach the gospel. I'm like, this is insane. I've been in church for 25 years, and I don't know how to do this. And thankfully, I remember what happened to Paul in Athens, and my daughters are gone in 2008. And they, of course, told me stories. So by the blessing of God, I was able to cobble both concepts together to be able to present to them the God that I worship. And he got me through that, but I was angry after that. I went back in my diary notes, and I was angry because I didn't know what to tell them, at the time. But I'm still learning. It's a long process, and because you have to talk to the people you're reaching in a way that's not confrontational, in a way that they understand. You know, can you imagine if Paul had insulted the Athenians? You know, I noticed when I went through your city, you guys are a bunch of pagans. You know, he'd be stoned to death. But he said, I noticed in all things you people are very religious. And I came upon this statue to the unknown God. Well, this is the one I come to present you. So preaching the gospel in India is a lot like that. The problem is a lot of Western churches go into India and expect the Indian churches to do things the way we do it here. Doesn't work. It fails every time. We have to equip them, build them up, and let them preach the gospel the way it needs to be preached so that they can reach as many people as is needed.
I was just making sure that I heard correctly that you explained the caste system. Mm-hmm. So there, let's say that you are professional and you're in the professional class. Mm-hmm. If you proclaim Christ, that takes you to an untouchable, that actually can remove you out of your class to becoming an untouchable?
Your life is over. I've done many baptisms there with Brahmins. We'd march because there's no privacy in India. I mean, it's going to surpass China in population either this year or next year. That's how crowded. There's no privacy. So, and water is a god. And they don't have running water, so you can't fill up a bathtub. It's very difficult. So most of the time you go to these little ponds, which are basically their drinking water, their toilet, and their laundry. So you go to these river canals that the British built when they ruled India, and we're defiling their god. But the Hindus see who's getting dunked and coming up out of the water. Now these are people that only understand, I want eternal life. There's no atheism in India. There's none. No atheism. They don't even understand it. They're very religious people. They want eternal life. Their Hindu system tells them reincarnation. They live this life because of the sins of their past life, if they're low caste, and if they suffer, if they shave their head as a widow, and they beat themselves and suffer, then maybe their gods will have compassion, and they will be resurrected to a higher caste when they're resurrected back to life. But as Christians, when they decide to make Jesus Christ their Lord and their Savior, when they walk down, they don't understand, they don't know anything about the Sabbath, or the holy days, or all the things that we have to study before we can counsel for baptism. They want Jesus Christ because I want eternal life. I'm going to make him my God. And they walk down and they go, and all the Hindus are watching or throwing bricks at us, and you baptize them. When they come up out of the water, if they had a job, they don't have one anymore. If they had a family, their family is kicking them out of the house onto the street, and they become destitute. These are people that want Christ to become the Lord and Savior, and they're willing to risk everything to become His without understanding all the stuff that we do. I never had to make that commitment when I was baptized. I just had to read all the literature and agree with it. I didn't make the commitment that knowing that when I came up out of the water, my family was going to throw me on the street and I was going to lose my job. And I was basically going to have to beg for a living. Never had to make that commitment. But those that God is calling in India, they're already sacrificing their lives to serve God. And all they understand is Jesus Christ is the Son of the Creator. And I want Him to be my God instead of all the Hindu gods. And that's basically mostly what they understand. They learn, as Chitty said, he was confused about how I got baptized. He's shaking his head. He says, Brother Michael, he says, I don't understand. He says, you do the baptism, and you lay the hands so the Holy Spirit comes. Then you teach them about Sabbath and holy days. You know, in his mind, he's like, well, you get baptized first, and the Holy Spirit then comes on them, and then they will understand. You were saying in USA, you have to, you know, understand before you're allowed to be baptized.
On the heels of that, I just wanted to mention that that's for Sabbatarian or mainstream Christians over there. In other words, there's less of a distinction, it seems, between here with our church culture or Sabbatarian culture. There's this division between Sabbatarians and mainstream Christians that, you know, keep the Easter, Christmas, and all that, Sunday and all. But there, it's like you profess Christ. It doesn't matter to the government or whoever, the Hindus, whether you're a Sabbatarian or a mainstream. If you claim Christ, that's it.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. Hindus and the Muslims make no distinction. They don't care what denomination you are. They're going to kill you anyway. Doesn't matter. You're non-human, and you're outside the caste. Of course, if you're a Muslim, you're infidel, and it's their duty to kill you. And it's funny because even there in India, the Sabbatarians, all the churches fight against each other. Because in their minds, the pie of support is finite, and they all want a slice of the financial pie. You know, so they're all think there's only limited amount of funds of donations to get from the USA. So they're all fighting amongst one another for dominance.
I think you answered part of my question, but I was wondering, so how do you originally reach them? I understood you to say that they're baptized and then they get to know the truth. But, like, how are you reaching them? Like, you can't proselytize. I mean, you can't go out in the streets, really, right? Or
oh no,
is
they
it
do.
Word of mouth.
No, or, they do.
They do. You do.
You
actually
read the Book of Acts, and that's what life's like in India to preach the gospel. When I was over there doing what they're doing, it's everything I read in the Book of Acts. It's they're standing on a two mud roads with tarps on the ground, playing instruments and proclaiming, "This is our God. We bring you repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." That's what they shout to everybody, and through bullhorns. Knowing that the Hindus are going to want to try and kill them. And it's astounding, but that's what they do. Baptisms are in river canals. You read the River Jordan, they come out, you know, but everybody has cell phones. We're living in the first century, but everyone has cell phones. It's just kind of nutty that way. Yeah, the government subsidized. Yep, government subsidized cell phones. They're not smartphones, they're like the flip phones we used to have, like, what, 10 years ago? Yeah, because they're very social people. So the government provides those to everybody because the government monitors everything.
And they do get punished.
Oh, yes.
Regularly, beaten, arrested on a regular basis. And they get out of jail and go back and do it again. In fact, my son was beaten and in jail. And as soon as he got out, he called us and said he was going to become a pastor.
His dragging king is screaming. He didn't want to be a pastor. On the opening night of the Feast of Tabernacles in 2010, the Hindu leader came in with the SWAT team. They beat every man, woman, and child with clubs in the church, arrested Pastor John, arrested my brother Chitty and Prasad, took them to jail. Prasad's sitting in jail and says, okay, I will become a pastor. So I could enjoy this every day, not just on the holy days.
When you were there, okay, how did they view you? Did they view you as part of this lower outside class, or were you looked at upon as a higher class with a, you know?
Yes, white people in India by the Hindus are regarded as a higher caste. They're below the labor caste, but we're still part of the caste because we're white. I don't know how they come to that conclusion, but they do. However, When the Hindus, by looking at Chidi, recognize he's a Christian, they're not going to sell him or do business, but if I'm with him, they recognize I'm a Christian, I get treated the same way they do. As a matter of fact, I was just telling someone yesterday, Amma Ruth needed a new propane stove. And I went to Kakinada with Brother Chidi, and we went to one shop. We went to the camp stove district. It's hilarious how in India, when you go shopping for anything, you have to go, they have blocks, and every stall is camp stoves. And every stall over here is bananas. And it's just weird. So we went to the one stall to look at the prices and seeing what they are. And you're not allowed to touch the merchandise in India. The shop owner has a table, and the items are behind him. And he brings it down, and he shows it to you. You're not allowed to touch. And then you make an agreement that I'm going to purchase it. He puts it back up on the shelf. You sign a piece of paper. You give him the cash, and then they go in the back and bring you out the other item. Well, Chitty was arguing with this guy because the guy guys could recognize that Chitty was low caste and said, I'm not selling to you. So then Chitty grabs me to bring me up. You'll sell to him. And I don't speak Telugu, so Chitty's still having to translate. And the guy was still yelling at Chitty. So I pulled, you know, here's the money, here's how much it cost. I put the money down. I sign the piece of paper. The guy puts the camp stove back. Goes back, comes back out, gives me the box, and I grab it, and all right, you go. And the box felt weird. Like, what is this? It doesn't feel right. And I could hear, so we get to our auto rickshaw, which is like a three-wheeled taxi, and I'm sitting in it. I go, Chitty, there's something right with this. I go, this shouldn't do this. You know, he's like, oh, that's the the metal parts. I open up the box, and it was rocks, box of rocks. So I got mad, and I'm going to go get up, and I'm going to complain, and they're grabbing me. No, 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 no. You will be arrested and beaten. Oh, Erica's giving me the signals to speed it up. Well, if anyone else, I'll be happy to entertain questions. And what is it? I just told them. You weren't listening. A box of rocks. And I'm not allowed to complain about it. Because if you complain about it, I will be beaten and arrested and thrown in jail. Because that's the law. You're not allowed to question a higher caste member. You're not allowed to talk to them. They're gods. And you're below, if you're below them. Yeah, but
you can't do that there.
You can't do that there. It doesn't work that way. I got a bicycle.
You can't touch the stuff.
Yeah, and long story afterward. You want to hear about the bicycle story? I'll be happy to tell you about the bicycle I bought. Yeah, he's laughing because he heard it. Yeah, it's insanity. It's just nuts. But that's in Indian culture. See, the thing that freaks out Americans, they don't even think the way we do. Their thought processes are not like ours. We're unique because we have a biblical foundation. In India, they've never been touched by the scriptures or the gospel other than what was happening through the Catholicism or what the brethren are doing over there. So they don't even think the way they do. To cheat, to steal, and rob someone is not a crime. If you're able to swindle and steal from someone and get away with it, you're applauded because you're clever. The more clever you are, the ability to sneak and cheat is you go up the ranks in Hinduism. That's the way. That's their morality. So that's yeah, their politics there make Cook County look tame in comparison. And I've been from Cook County, and it's pretty bad. So, last question.
If anybody doesn't know what Cook County is, that's the Chicago County.
Chicago, bang bang. Anyone else have a question? Okay, well, I want sincerely, on behalf of the Brethren in India, thank you everybody for coming out and letting me share their testimony with you. If people are finding out, if you ask me questions about India, I'll talk your ear off till I can't talk anymore. Because I love talking about what God's doing with them, and there's hilarious stories from an American perspective. I'd be happy to talk with you at any point. Any questions or comments you have? I have zillions of stories. If you want to hear about the miracles that God performed to get me there, come talk to me at any time during the feast. I'd be happy to share where they are amazing.
They don't have as many stories as they have gods.
That's true. 300 million major government-sanctioned deities in India. 300 million. Satan owns India. That's his territory. I don't remember which book in the Old Testament was it that was it Michael or Gabriel that was trying to go to Daniel and he couldn't because the Prince of Persia was preventing him. He couldn't because there's territories they own. India is one of those. So as a Christian, we're intruding on his territory, and he hates it, and it causes issues. And so that's what happens. Anyway, namaste. Thank you very much, Danya Wadamalu, for coming out to the seminar this morning, and enjoy your fellowship.